This is the fourth episode of MK Band-Aid with myself, Gary Cool, and these are your top news stories of the week. Cape Town fast-paced punk rock band Dead Lucky have released their debut full-length album titled Sons of Lazarus, and they'll be launching the album on the 31st at Bohemian Stellenbosch, 1st of November at Carnival Court, and lastly, Wilma Bush Lounge on the 2nd of November in Pretoria. And some sad news, it's been a month of band breakups. First, retro metalers Sabretooth announced that they are splitting, and now Belleville rockers Dogtown have decided to call it a day, and their last show will be on the 10th of October at Bohemia. And lastly, Park Life have announced their lineup for the festival at Mark's Park in Joburg on the 24th of November. The lineup includes Jeremy Loops, Matthew Mole, Taxi Violence Unplugged, Short Straw, ISO, The Dirty Skirts, and of course, Seether. In this week's episode of MK Band-Aid, we chat to well-known publicist Mike Pocock about publicists and how to promote your band and event successfully. This is MK Band-Aid.
One thing about PR is that the PR person must never strive to be more famous than the acts that he's PRing, because then what's the point of doing it? Because you are there to service your client, who are your bands, your acts, your events, whatever you've been employed to do the PR for. I think it takes a lot of passion, and you have to be interested in it yourself to take it to the next level. Really, it's one of those professions which is 24/7. There's no holiday. Everything, it just goes and goes and goes. And you know what? I've never actually worked a day in my life, because I just love the job so much.
That's awesome. How long have you been doing it for, and how did you get into it?
I've been doing it for about 7 years now. I started off at David Gresham Records. Actually started off as an intern there. I basically just emailed the boss there and just said I'd like to do an internship unpaid, and I packed my car up from Cape Town, drove up to Joburg, did it, and then they actually ended up offering me a job, full-time job there.
Wow.
So yeah, it was a big risk, but I wanted to be involved in music, so that's the, you know, it's a risk I took, and it paid off. I was lucky enough to work with, you know, big artists, local artists such as, you know, Jesse Clegg, Nutty Nice, Lady Lear, and then also international artists back then when they had Roadrunner with Nickelback, Slipknot, Tiesto. You know, I was very fortunate. I learned a hell of a lot from there, and David Gresham is a legend in the music industry.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah. So yeah, I mean, it happened. It just kind of happened, but it was something I really wanted to do, and yeah, I went for it.
So, did you just want to get into music, or was it specifically PR that you wanted to get into?
Well, I studied, I got my degree in marketing management, so I wanted to do something in behind the scenes of music. I've never been a performer, a musician per se, but always been fascinated by how does the music industry work. And I basically just wanted to be more behind the scenes, behind it, on, like, you know, how do record companies pick the first single? How do they get the band's name out there? How do they get their tracks on radio, on TV, everywhere like that? Yeah, and it's basically always wanted to be always wanted to work in the entertainment industry, and music was just my first passion. So yeah, just that's how I wanted to get into it. Well, I mean, there's lots of courses out there to study PR, and I mean, there is a standard textbook way of doing PR, but also PR is one of those professions where you learn something new every day, and I think it's adapting, and also, you know, trying to, rather than following a trend, set a trend in PR rather. I mean, here we've got, in this day and age, we've got so many free ways of promoting yourselves, and to stand above the rest, you know, you as a PR need to think of ways on how to do that. I think that just one way for people who want to get into PR is research the media, get to know your media, get to know your media's target market, and really just focus on trying to, what's the best way to get a message out there. it's a very tough industry because there are a lot of PR people out there, and it just takes a lot to stand above the rest to get your message out there. Well, it is a very good question, actually. Look, I mean, at the end of the day, the manager is the person who is taking your career and setting it in stone. He's the one who's, you know, making sure you are looking at, you know, endorsement deals, sponsorships. You know, he'll work very closely with the booking agent to make sure you get the right shows to perform at the right fees. Mm. The PR person is then that person who will take the band's assets, such as singles, gigs, and promote that to promote your show. So it does work hand in hand together. I believe that if you have a very good manager and you've got a very good PR person, they gel together, you've got a very unstoppable force behind you. Mm. So I would say the two work hand in hand. I'll say a PR person is not an A&R person. So therefore your manager should be an A&R person. So a PR can't get your a number one hit on the radio station if the manager hasn't guided the band to have a number one hit.
True.
So it's basically, I would say, invest in your management first, mm-hmm. and then obviously look for a PR that gels with the band and also is somebody who is passionate about the music and wants it to make success, not only as their profession, but also as a fan of the band, to want to see it get to number one.
Mm.
I think one of the most rewarding aspects of PR is seeing that act make it to number one, or get a gold or platinum record, or sell out, you know, or sell out a stadium or a club, it's something so small. It's basically filling up a club on one of their first shows. You know, it's basically promotes that show to the best you can.
Yeah,
and yeah, it's a very rewarding feeling to be part of that process. Yes, I do think they're important because it's instant information.
Mm.
It's fast-paced information. We live in a digital age where people are hounded with hundreds, if not more, articles a day. And, you know, if a blog or somebody really supports your cause that you're sending out as a PR, it does help you. It does help quite a bit. I mean, the trend in the is that, you know, online is becoming more valuable nowadays. I think it's definitely important to look at websites and blogs as huge beneficial factors in the world of PR.
But then you have the PR agents that still see more value in print. Are they stuck in the old days, or do they still have
it's a very interesting topic because I still see print as very, very valuable. Mm. Also with the way print is going, sadly, we're getting more and more publications. Print publications are now only going on digital.
Mm.
They're trying to move forward, which is great. But I see the value is not greater than online. I mean, it's much of a match. It depends on your readers.
Yeah.
Like, if you have a let's just say an under 18 show, you get it into the Tonight section of the Star or Cape Argus. Yes, it's great for the parents reading that page. You know, okay, it's an under 18 party, but online and social media is where your target market is. It all depends on where your target market, who your target market is. Find out what they read. Find out where they look for their information and target those avenues to get your information out there. It's great sending out a blanket PR release to everybody, but follow up on your targeted avenues, like your blogs, your websites, depending on what crowd audience you're looking for. If you're looking for an older audience, hit up the Jacaranda FMs, hit up the the Highfall to cater for that basically 35 and above. It's a case by case scenario, but no. It's basically, print is not more valuable than online. I would say they are equal at the moment.
Now, when it comes to a band that can't afford a PR agent right now, what should they know in order to do their own PR? Because there's a lot of bands doing a lot of things wrong. So what are those things that are wrong that you shouldn't do?
Well, look, I mean, the only way they're going to learn is by, you know, making the, I don't want to say mistakes, but, you know, it's basically, bands need to realize that their art form is a product and it's a brand at the end of the day. And when you're speaking about that brand from a PR perspective, you mustn't be speaking it from a, I'm a band man perspective. You need to put on the, your PR hat or your manager hat and speak from that perspective. Look, because not everybody, every journalist out there is going to like the music. It rarely happens. And you have to learn how to take criticism. And it's one of the aspects where you have to take that criticism with a pinch of salt and say, okay, it's not, and it's not personal at all. If it doesn't work for a publication, it doesn't work, or a radio station or whatever. But I think what bands need to realize is that the way, remember that these media are dealing with hundreds of PR people a day. How do you stand out from everyone else? How are you going to make that music compiler at that big radio station remember who you are, what your track is, and if they don't like your first track, what are they, you know, how are you going to get them in with the next one? It's pretty much, it's a big relationship building exercise at the end of the day. And also another thing is that it doesn't matter who that person is. It could be at like the smallest radio station in the country. Build up a relationship with them, because you never know where they might land up. They might become the music compiler at the biggest station in the country. So I think that's one thing to remember is, you know, stay humble. Don't burn your bridges. At the end of the day, not everybody gets along with everybody. There are personality clashes, but be professional about it, and don't take criticism too personally, because it's not, nobody's attacking you on a personal level if they don't playlist your track or write an article about you. If you're a black metal band, don't go and put your music on, like, you know, Kai FM or something like that.
But that is one thing, thanks for bringing that up, is that there is one band I can think of that their music is good, but they're not getting airplay because they're not targeting, say, a KFM audience. They're targeting a 5FM audience because they want to be on a 5FM rather than a KFM, because to them that's cooler. But at the end of the day, that's not who their target market is, really.
No, I mean, it's a very good point, and it does happen. And I mean, it sometimes takes, you know, there might be, bands might be, submitting to five, getting rejected, and then they might say, okay, then they must try submit to KFM. And also, the music compilers are there to also, you know, ask for their advice. Ask them, why was it not playlisted? You know, you're just asking why, the bands have more than enough reason to know why wasn't it playlisted. And take that and take that information and learn from it. I mean, you know, we also don't want to, at the end of the day, as a PR, we don't want bands to lose total creativity and just, you know, we want them to be original.
Yeah.
But at the same time, take it as advice at the end of the day, and don't take it personally.
Number one is knowing your marketers.
Yeah, know your marketers.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, number two would be, you know, build your image. There's so many different bands out there, and they all have pretty photo shoots in the forest. And, you know, do something original and wacky. I mean, like, a band like Old Bear has done something, you know, they had a photo shoot while they're in the bath, for example, and I mean, that will probably get published quite a lot. You know, be original, be out the box. But at the same time, play it safe. You don't want to be too controversial just starting out. And the third point is, you know, just stay humble and always make time for interviews and opportunities to get your music out there, because there are people who want to hear it, and there's also lots of people who want to discover new music, so why not let them discover your band's music?
If you had to invest money in one thing, would it be a writer to write a great bio for you?
I think bars are very, very important, and yes, I would invest money into it, because at the end of the day, it's something that if somebody doesn't know who you are, it's the first piece of writing they're going to read about your band.
Mm.
So before they even hear the music. So I think it's very important to make it stand out, be catchy, make it interesting, but don't make it too long either. Don't tell everybody what high school you went to and, you know, that you play trombone in the band, because no one cares.
That wraps up the fourth episode of MK Band-Aid with myself, Gary Cool. Thank you so much to Mike Pocock for the valuable information he shared with us. Please follow Mark on Twitter at MikePocock1 and feel free to ask him for any advice in regards to PR. Upcoming episodes feature Dead Letter Circus, Al Bear, and Gangs of Ballet. Be sure to subscribe to MK's YouTube channel and follow MK on Twitter at MKTV_ and follow me at Gary Cool_. Take care, ciao ciao.